grandpa's old-fashioned, and he's my pastor, so I'm old-fashioned. When you run with a hog, you start smelling like one, acting like one. So I'm a hog this morning. But anyway, Exodus chapter number 17. Again, I cannot thank your church and your pastor enough for this invitation to come back. When we were here last year for the homecoming with Preacher Sherman Branch, I didn't know him from a branch out on the tree, but he came and introduced himself over in the fellowship hall, and he had us a couple weeks later over at his church for revival. And from there, we got three appointments, engagements to go and sing at other churches and preach in revivals. And the Lord has just blessed our ministry and our family, and I want to be a blessing to him by preaching the truth this morning. If you're in the book of Exodus, chapter number 17, if you wouldn't mind standing with me briefly for the reading of God's word, and we would begin reading this morning in verse number 9. And Moses said unto Joshua, choose us out men and go out, fight with Amalek tomorrow. I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in mine hand. So Joshua did as Moses had said to him, and he fought with Amalek. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And it came to pass, when Moses held up his hand, that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy, and they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat thereon. And Aaron and Hur stayed up his hands, the one on the one side and the other on the other side, and his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. Let's bow our head for prayer. Lord, we come before you, and we're humbled and we're honored that you would allow us to be back here this morning. We pray now, Father, that you would take this word, it's your word, and help me preach and say, God, what you need these people to hear. Lord, let me be a voice for you. And I pray that you'll do this and you will honor it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. You can be seated this morning. If I had to put a title on the sermon this morning, I would title the name of the sermon, The Power of Lifting Up Your Hands. Think about that. The power of lifting up your hands. Real briefly, we find here in this passage of Scripture that Amalek and Israel are in a war against each other. And instead of fighting, Moses insists that he's going to go sit on the top of the hill and pray. And as long as his hands are up toward heaven, Israel is prevailing. But when he lets his hands down, the Bible says, Amalek begins to prevail. I want to take this morning and give you 3 points and turn it into us today, Christians. In spiritual battles, in physical battles, financial battles, so many times when we face a battle, the first thing that we should do is fall on our knees and say, Lord, I'm unfit to fight this battle. I'm unequipped to fight this battle. I don't have the knowledge to fight this battle. But you, God, knew about this battle before I did. And you have the power to fight the battle for me. So God, I give it to you. And if you'll do that, whatever the battle is, my friend, you will prevail. However, I've been there. I know what it's like. I'm human. You're human. When we find ourselves in a battle, the last thing that we do is pray. Is that right? No. But again, we're human. And we think that we know it all. Nobody in the world knows as much as C.J. Shetley. And so we try our best to fix the problem. And I'm reminded of a very true illustration. Several months ago, before this sermon came to me, I went downstairs at home early one morning, and I thought I knew my house well enough. I didn't need to turn any lights on. I would go straight into the kitchen and fix me a huge platter of waffles and then cake them up with that thick syrup. So then I decided I would go back upstairs to my study, and that's where I'd have my breakfast. Didn't turn any lights on. So as I started up the steps, I missed one. And I fell backwards and sprained my ankle. And not only did I sprain my ankle, the plate shattered on the tile floor at the bottom of the steps. Now, before I turned the light on and before I thought what I should do, my instinct was automatically to quickly put my hands down in the mess, pick all that up with two bare hands, and move on. However, I thought, paused for just a minute, and I thought, I better first turn the light on. And then I thought, if I try to clean this up with my bare hands, I'm liable to get cut. And then I'd be bleeding, so I'd have another mess. So I thought smart. I do need to turn the light on. I need to go get some appropriate tools to clean this up and to throw this garbage away. If when we face a battle, that's a real illustration, but if when we face a battle, we wouldn't be so quick to bend down and try to fix everything on our own, we wouldn't end up hurt. Many, many times when we face battles and we think that we're capable of handling them on our own, we get cut, so to speak, just as I would have gotten cut that morning. And then we're bleeding inside. And there's another problem. But first, I want to challenge you in your next battle. Maybe you're in a battle this morning. I want to challenge you to be like Moses. Remove yourself from the situation. Now, you may say, "Preacher, that is absurd. I cannot remove myself from the situation. It involves me." Yes, you can. You can back out, sit down, and pray your way through. You have the tools through the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to make it. So the first point I want to make when you're in battle is to pray. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 teaches us to pray without ceasing. Maybe you're here this morning and you've been in a battle, or you are in a battle, or you know you're getting ready to be in a battle. And you say, "Preacher, time and time again in battle, I've done that. I've prayed." Well, how long have you prayed? A lot of people think that prayer means to say, "Lord, fix it and fix it now." And then you've prayed about it and you don't ever have to pray again. But can I remind you of Elijah? This is another story, but Elijah on top of Mount Carmel, the Bible says, was praying for God to send some rain. Now, he didn't pray for 3 minutes or 3 seconds or 3 weeks or 3 days, but he prayed for 3.5 years that God would send the rain. He prayed without ceasing. And the end result was a cloud fashioned as the hand of God, and the rain came. So when in battle, the first thing to do is pray, and not just pray one prayer, but pray your way through. Pray without ceasing. Secondly, when you pray in battle, you will prevail in battle. Amen? We see that as long as Moses was praying, they were prevailing. Amen? So if you'll pray, you will prevail. And I want to read you another verse of scripture from the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter number 1 and verse 19 says, "And they shall fight against thee." I like this. "But they shall not prevail against thee, for I am with thee, saith the Lord, to deliver thee." That's a promise to us. He's with us. Help is always available when you're on the Lord's side. But first, you must ask. I have found that Christians today and in almost every church are consumed with one thing: pride. Pride has consumed us as individuals. And when we face battles, we are too prideful to make our way to an old-fashioned altar and ask God for help. I want to brag on your church that there's still an altar here. Many churches no longer have a place for people to pray. And you know why? People weren't using the altar, so they took them out. But you have the promise that the enemy shall fight against you, yes, but they shall not prevail against you. So see, when you pray and give it to God and take your hands out of the situation and say, "Lord, I'm not capable of fighting, but rather you are, so I give my battle to you. You don't fight, you don't put your hands in the circumstance, But you pray, then you prevail. Amen? There's a prayer that Jehoshaphat prayed, and down at the bottom of his prayer in the scripture, he said, Lord, maybe paraphrasing, Lord, we don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. A lot of times in battle when we're trying to fight, our eyes are on the situation. Our hands are in the mess. But when you lift up your hands and you say, Lord, I don't know what to do, then lifting up means looking up. And when you're looking up, your eyes are on the Heavenly Father. And the enemy shall not prevail against you. As a little boy, my grandpa, who is my pastor, instilled in me, there's nothing more important in the life of a Christian than prayer. Things are going to happen, and I'm a living testimony. Things will happen that you're not prepared for, that you've not planned for. But instead of trying to figure out a solution on your own, pray and give it to God. As a little boy, my brother and I were raised at home, and one day I was a little older than my brother by about 2 years, and so I comprehended things slightly better than he did. And my dad and mom set us down in the living room and told us late one night that things were just not working out between the two of them, and they were going to have to separate. And my brother didn't quite comprehend that, but I did. And very heartbroken, I ran to the back of the house and I grabbed the phone and I called my grandma. And she answered and she knew nothing about it. And I was crying and I said, Mama, my mom and dad are going to be separating. And so she began to cry. And that created a more chaotic scene. I was crying and she was crying. So then my papa went in there and he said, why are you crying, honey? And she explained what was going on. And he said, well, there's probably a chaotic situation already over at their house, and you're making it chaotic here. And he got on the phone, and he reminded us to pray. You can't fix the unfortunate circumstances in your life, but God can. And you've got to pray and give it to Him. So he began to pray over the phone, and it was a Saturday night, and I always stayed at Mama and Papa's house on Saturday night. I would be in church on Sunday morning, and he said, we'll go ahead and come over and get you, CJ, and we'll just keep on praying. And they came and picked me up, and we started praying at their house. And he reminded me to pray without ceasing. So all night I prayed, and weeks went by, and months went by, and I continued to pray. And I asked God to please save my dad and mom, and I asked Him to do whatever it takes to fight the battle for me. I was so small and I was uneducated, but He knew what to do. A few months went by and we got word that my dad, who was a police officer, had been called in a scandal. He was going to be sentenced to some time in prison. And I felt like that plate I illustrated had just crumbled all around me. There was a mess. My mom and dad were separated. And I said, Lord, I've prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed, and things aren't getting any better, but rather things are getting worse. And my dad went to prison, and I talked to my papa, and he said, son, I didn't tell you to pray for a little while, but I told you to pray without ceasing. That's what God's told us to do. So we continued to pray, and we asked God to do what it would take. And some people in prison get saved. They really get it. And I thank God when that happens. But there's a lot of people that get what I call prison religion. And my dad was one of them. He wanted out, and he got prison religion. And he made promises that he didn't keep to me and my brother. Letters that he wrote promising to come home and be a different man. And you know, God, when you know the Lord and you run from Him, He'll snatch you back up, and it may not be in a way that you will be happy with. So my dad got out of prison, and we were still praying. By this point, my grandpa had convinced me to pray, Lord, whatever it takes now, you know, you do whatever it takes. And 6 months to the day after my dad came home, and he was back in his sinful lifestyle. We got a phone call late one night, about 11:30 on a Saturday night. I was at my grandparents' house again, and the other person on the end of the phone was crying and wailing, and they said, "Oh God, preacher, your son has been killed in a motorcycle accident." And you know, sometimes little children do what we're not supposed to do. We eavesdrop. So I had picked up the phone, and I was doing that awful thing of eavesdropping. And I just felt like, for the third time in my life, that plate, that illustration, my world had just crumbled. Now, not in a few pieces or 100 pieces, but in a million pieces, and I could not fix the situation. But I was reminded once again, when in battle, pray. So all the way to the hospital that night, I prayed, and my papaw prayed, and I've come to remind you this morning, there is a reason for all of this. There is power in prayer. The Bible says the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. We got to the hospital, and the doctor met us at the door and said, "We're sorry that they told you your son had been killed. They did pronounce him dead, but on the way to the hospital, they found some pulse and things like that, and he did lose his leg, and he did lose his arm, but he pulled through that. 10 weeks in a coma, and 10 months in rehab. When he woke up and was rehabilitated, they came to the family, and they told us that they wanted him to go back home, but he had to have 24-hour care. Now, my mother had a job doing well, raising us 2 children. I wasn't happy that my parents weren't together, but, you know, God knew what he was doing. And she stepped into the room, and my grandfather was sitting there with the doctor, and she said, "I'll take care of him." All those years of prayers the Lord had answered for me that day. And my grandpa said, "Honey, are you sure?" And this is what I want you to hear this morning. She said, "I forgive him." Forgiveness is a very difficult thing, but if you're sitting in a church pew this morning and you've got something against someone and you're refusing to forgive them, you need to get right. Because without forgiving your brother, you can't be forgiven of your sins. And the Bible says if we say that we love God whom we have not seen, how do we not love our brother whom we have seen? So she had a real love for him, and God answered my prayer that day and restored my family. And the third point I want to give to you, once you've prayed your way through and you've found yourself at the end of the battle and you've prevailed, the enemies fought hard against you, as we read in Jeremiah, but they have not prevailed against you. The third and final thing to do is to praise the Lord. Pray, prevail, and praise. That day when the Lord answered all my prayers at one time, my family was back together, my dad had survived, he was back home, and my mom forgave him, I could have just taken for granted that the Lord answered my prayers. But if we do that too much, he may stop listening. So I had to praise him for all that he had done. When you pray, you'll prevail. And all the pieces around you that are shattered, don't try to put it back together. Give it to God. He can. And when he does, you be sure to praise him. 1 Thessalonians 5:18 says, "In everything, give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you." Are you in a battle this morning? Are you trying to fight the battle on your own? Are you too prideful to come to the altar and give it to God for fear of what he or she might think or say? Don't be, my friend, because Aaron and Hur came and held up Moses' hands when he grew weary. And your brothers and sisters in Christ aren't here to ridicule you or to point their finger when you come and give your battle to God, but they're here to come and hold your hands up so that when your hands are high and lifted up, you can prevail in the battle. There is power in prayer, and there's power in taking your hands out of the situation, lifting them up, and giving your battle to God. Would you stand with me this morning?